Joey, what happened to the shell dwellers? Joey, what happened to the small fish? Joey, what's going on with the Lake Tanganyika aquariums? Well, today, we're gonna go in depth and find out what's been going on. So not too long ago, we set up not one, but two Lake Tanganyika African cichlid aquariums. I set up two because there was two different species of African shell dwellers that I just absolutely had to have, but this time we mixed it up and stocked it with some tank mates. We got, in this tank, we have some Lamprolongus multifasciatus. This is one of the most, if not the most common shell dweller that you can have. We also got some Gelidochromis regani. And this is a small, very active, colorful fish. We're actually gonna go over these fish here in a moment and some details about them. And then of course we got the Goldhead Compriceps. Or I believe many of you guys are trying to correct me in the comments, and every time I say Compriceps, it's Compriceps? You know what I'm trying to say. I'm showing the fish and a lot of times giving common names. So how did things work out? Well, you guys will also remember, we set up this scape to accommodate the fish, requiring really three basic areas of the tank, three different territories type of deal. We did a bit of a rock scape that kind of trails off to the corner there. We added in some sand, of course. We added in some shells for the shell dwellers. And then at last, added in some plants. The plants are the first thing I want to talk about and what happened next. Obviously, I like the dramatic lighting coming in like this. It looks like sunlight hitting the tank. I absolutely love it. It looks okay on camera, but I can assure you it looks awesome in person. We went with some low light, easy to keep plants like the Anubias, as well as the Java ferns. A couple of the plants dislodge themselves. Some of you might find that annoying seeing them float around. I like to let things naturally occur in the tank as opposed to forcing it, because I want it to be easy to maintain and last long term. The plants, some of them are growing a little bit of algae on them. Some look to be withering away, but for the most part, they're all doing just fine. I do see new roots on almost all of it, so time will tell what happens here. I can add a little bit of supplements to the tank, but these fish, we do have, what do we have, like 60 fish in this tank, and I know it looks like nothing's in here, but within a few months we're going to have fish that are a lot bigger and look a lot fuller and far more activity. Let's start off with the multifasciatus. We were only able to get our hands on about 17 of them, and we still have 17. I am noticing at this relatively small size some signs of pairing up, but I'm not positive. They're still small. There is signs of courtship. Now, keep in mind, I've bred these before, so I do know what to look for and see. If you're not familiar with the African shell dwellers, it's exactly what it sounds like. They live in these tiny little shells, and in their natural environment, it's just sand and shells for as far as you can see. They live in them, they breed in them. They only stay to maybe a 1.5 inch maximum size. They're a fantastic beginner fish for such a tiny fish. Typically, the smaller the fish is, the harder it can be to keep. A lot of the times they're more sensitive, but these guys are pretty hardy. They'll breed readily. You don't need any experience. They're almost like a convict cichlid, for example, if you guys are familiar with those from Central America. Eat readily, you know, just so easy to care for, but I do find success with a lot of tinier fish, and that is adding them into established tanks that have detritus and some algae and other things for them to nibble on if the food's not getting to them. As for the regani, or the julies as they're most commonly called, these guys, apart from the shell dwellers, they do spend some time throughout the entire tank, but they stay to the bottom 25%, sticking to the rock structure unless I come near it. I do notice some territorial action happening. I see some tail slapping, perhaps some courting, but for the most part, no losses there at all. We still have all the multifasciatus, we still have all the julies, and they are doing really well. I do find out of this tank, although I have a soft spot for these shell dwellers, and I do enjoy the Compriceps, at this given point in time, my favorite fish in the tank are definitely the Julies. And once again, this is an easy beginner fish. Pretty active, they will need lots of caves and cover. These guys are a cave-dwelling, cave-breeding cichlid. And over time, they will get a lot bigger. Probably maxing out in the aquarium at 2.5-3 inches. You know, in the wild, of course, they can potentially get a lot bigger, but you know, a lot of the times they don't get, a lot of wild fish simply just do not, or tank-raised fish simply do not get to wild sizes. Then we have the Compriceps, very interesting fish. And again, these guys are spending their time in the midsection of the aquarium. Some of them do go into the rock structure, but they do not dwell in there. They do not spend a tremendous amount of time in there. They're the most open fish, and these guys are probably going to get the biggest in the aquarium. Those guys in the Julies. And this is going to definitely be an interesting tank to watch over time. I do find that the most interesting behavior I'm seeing thus far is definitely these Julies or the Regani. And then the shell dwellers, but I'm so used to the shell dwellers. If you want a small, tiny fish or something that's packed full of personality and absolutely fascinating to watch, you should try shell dwellers, of course. They're hardy, they're pretty affordable. They can be tough to come by because they don't breed in large numbers, but definitely a rewarding fish, and they could do great in something like a 10-gallon, get a handful of them, like 6 or 8 of them. In no time though, you'll have a ton of fry. Usually within 6 months, you're definitely gonna have some. This tank is not my favorite of the shell-dwelling aquariums though. My favorite is the other one, and let me show you one. So when it comes to this African cichlid tank, we went with two different species. I love this aquarium, not because of the background or the plants or the scape, although it is pretty awesome. And again, we use the one light, which is shining through, kind of looking like sunlight once again. I think that looks absolutely amazing for African cichlids from, of course, Lake Tanganyika. You can also play with your lights at times, maybe move your lights closer to the front, maybe move it to the back, maybe angle it a little bit. You should do that with your aquarium right after you watch this video. Go try a few different positions of the lighting. It might make the tank look dramatically different and even showcase the fish off 100% better. A lot of times we just put the light in the center of the tank and that's what we've accepted, but go ahead and bring it all the way to the front, or maybe push it all the way back. Maybe you're only lighting a certain portion. It could look pretty awesome. Downside with me lighting it like this though is, of course, we have plants in here, those live plants. A lot of people didn't think they'd survive, but they're still alive. They're still doing okay. The roots, I do see new roots on there. They're surviving. They're not thriving. I think if I just clump them all up underneath the light, that would look better. Ultimately, in the long run, I'm probably gonna move them to another tank or something along those lines. Then we have, of course, have tons of snail shells once again and some sand. Very basic, very simple scape. We have two species in here. We of course have the bigger ones, which are the Neolamprolongus lililupi, or however you pronounce that, commonly known as the lemon cichlid. And the main attraction for me and what I like in this tank the most out of even both of them is these gold oscillatus. This is another species of Lake Tanganyika shell dwellers. These guys do get a little bit bigger, getting to probably be closer to 2 inches or so, but they do dwell within the shells as well. They breed in them, they sleep in them, they rest in them, they spawn in them, they do everything within them. They bury them, they move them. It's a great fish, but the difference with these guys is not their subtle coloration, it's not their it's their attitude and the eyes. The eyes are like just at the tops of their heads, and it almost looks like a chameleon that could kind of almost move them around, if you know what I mean. That cracks me up all the time, but their attitudes, they're really boisterous for such a small fish. I think we only got like, what do we start with? We can only get our hands on 9. They're all still in here still. They are putting on size. They've almost doubled in size since we've had them, but they spend their time wherever they want, usually near the shells, but they're not in it all the time like the multifasciatus, for example. These guys are constantly out, constantly exploring, bickering amongst each other, showing, flaring up. It is just a fascinating little fish to watch, and I absolutely love their subtle coloration. They've got this like black and neon blue behind their gill plate. The eyes are awesome. A little flash of iridescence down the side. And then the rest of the body is like a light green. Their dorsal fin also is etched with a bit of yellow, or I could be wrong on these colors, but they're just such interesting fish to watch. The lemon cichlid is beautiful. From afar, look fantastic. They look great, but doesn't matter how close or how far up you get, they look the same, if you know what I mean. But with these oscillators, when you get in closer, they just become more and more fascinating the closer you watch them, the longer you watch them. And this is a tank that I just love to monitor and of course feed. Bottom line is both tanks are doing fantastic. We've all still had 100% success rate, even though I didn't think that was going to be the case. But feeding these tanks are both uniquely different as well. Today we're just gonna feed them a tiny bit of a small granule of a herbivoric diet. We'll start with this tank since we're already here. So of course with this tank, you can see I've angled it to almost be like a faster portion of the lake, or you know, turbulence, making them work for their food, making them constantly active. But what I do with this tank is really simple. Just take a bit of food, I'm actually not gonna give them all of this, and I drop it right into this stream, just like that. And they all start going for it. Easy to feed because they all eat the same diet. Now, of course, the food is just gonna roll around, but you can see they all share in this diet. They all eat it. I don't like to feed this tank too much because once again, these guys are pretty small. You can almost think of them like when you get into these tiny little fish, they're almost like betta. You only give them a few little pellets here and there. And I just want to make sure they each get a few and that's it. Other than that, the food will just collect and pollute the aquarium. So I want to make sure that we are feeding them. The one thing about these lemon cichlids though is you get so many different... They do go through color changes throughout the day. Sometimes they're yellower than normal, other times a little bit darker, like this guy coming over here, he's darker than the rest. But sometimes they're just absolutely bright yellow. But look at this oscillator, see what I'm saying? Aren't they gorgeous? Look at them. Like back here, he's just a tiny little fish, but we come up and we look and we observe him. And he's just so much more fascinating. See what I'm saying about the eyes? They're killing me. They look like they're so, I don't know, curious, angry, grumpy, tiny little grumpy fish. I don't know, it's funny to me. There's one here. And then look at this, is the same species right here. A lot more coloration. I would say, bottom line, these guys are probably the bosses of the tank. Even though I'm feeding these guys a 1 millimeter pellet as well, they do seem to struggle with eating it. Almost holding it in their mouth for a little while, waiting for it to soften and then eating it. But yeah, they're all getting enough. They're all growing. Yeah, this tank is just absolutely fascinating. Love it. Absolutely love these little African shell dwellers. But those guys get a lot bigger in comparison to the multifasciatus. So I can only imagine if I'm loving them right now and they're like a quarter inch, they're no bigger than the width of your pinky fingernail. I can only imagine what they're gonna be like when they are, you know, what, 5-10 times that size? So feeding this tank is different than the last, but it's not incredibly difficult or complicated. I want to make sure that the shell dwellers actually get some before all these guys eat it. So what I'll do is I'll feed these guys over here. Typically they'll all see it, they'll all go over the food. They see me right now, so they're not really too interested. There they go. Yeah, so they'll go over there, and while they're distracted with food, I'll go ahead and drop some right over the shell dwellers, and they'll get that. See, as it falls down, it just goes right over the shells. Some of the food even goes in the shells so that the shell dwellers can get at it. Even if they can't come out, they can at least eat right at home. I'm basically a fish food delivery service at this point, right to their door. And then, of course, these guys are all getting whatever they want. And some of the food will float just due to surface tension on the water. It's a sinking pellet, but due to the physics of surface tension, some of it will float as well. But most of it sinks, and they all get a little bit at the bottom here. But as you can see, like I said, the Julies spend a lot more time at the bottom and eating off the bottom. And then the Compriceps, if you can see them kind of gathering all near the top here, and they're more so prone to eat from the top. So if I were to do these fish individually, I'd definitely feed Compriceps something floating and everybody else in here sinking. But
I'm definitely feed whatever I'm giving, they all get the same thing. Now the tanks get about 25% water change once a week. I change out the filling, the polyester filling from the filter once to twice a week. That's it, that's it. Let's look at this random Anubias Thana. Just floating by, having a good time. I think he wants some camera time. But yeah, I just let that stuff float. And so maintenance is super simple, super easy. Since setting up this tank, there's been no gravel vacuuming. There's been no siphoning. These guys are pretty good at keeping the tank clean. They're not necessarily a tank cleaner, but that just goes to show proper filtration as well as circulation and no overfeeding. I feed them what I know they're gonna eat within a short period of time, and then I call it a day. Although it's fun to feed these guys, a lot of times they'll only eat once a day, sometimes twice, but that goes for the entire gallery. Now here's a pro tip. The pH of an African cichlid tank and the hardness is supposed to be pretty high, and a pH of over 8 for sure. I keep these tanks at a pH of anywhere between 7.6 to 7.8. I feed them once to twice a day, their water changes 25% once a week, and I change their filter media. I know that these are beginner type fish, but here's the pro tip. I do that for absolutely every tank in here. They are identical in temperature, identical in pH and hardness. They get the same amount of food and water changes. It's just different amounts of food or different kinds of food depending on the fish. And of course, the amount of water change might be slightly different if we get into the bigger guys. But the point that I'm going to make here is that I know that a lot of people chase numbers. They want to figure out, you know, the water coming out of their tap is a 7 and their cichlids need a 8.5. So they'll add a pH adjuster and try to raise it. They do a water change, it lowers it. Or maybe they added some wood and it lowers it, or added some rocks, it raises it. Everybody that's new to the hobby is worried about those numbers. The pH, the hardness, the GH, the DH, you name it. The only thing that matters out here is consistency. I don't care if it's ideal, I care that it's consistent. Because if you think about it, do you think your fish prefer you chasing these numbers and the parameters going up and down? Or do you think they prefer something that's a little bit more stable, yet maybe it's not ideal? Bottom line with that though is that most of the fish you're keeping are being tank raised in water conditions very similar to what you already have. So in my opinion, and the more success that you're gonna have, if you wanna be successful as a beginner hobbyist in the hobby, don't chase those numbers. Worry about the nitrogen cycle, ammonia, nitrite, as well as nitrate. And I guess I'm gonna leave that with you guys. What do you think is a good tip for beginners? Or if you are a beginner, what's something that you learned from the hobby that you'd like to share with others? Let everybody know in the comments section below. I just wanted to do this quick update for you guys, a nice light update. I am gonna dive deep into each species of fish like we have with walru and other fish in the past. If that's something you wanna see, make sure that you subscribe to this channel so you don't miss it if you're not subscribed already. And also let me know in the comments section below if that's something you wanna see. I'm horrible at these outros. I know I'm also supposed to start talking about my merch. If you want one of these shirts, go ahead and get it. It's in the link below. I also wrote a book that a lot of people don't even know, 552 page book on, what do we title that? The Ultimate Do-It-Yourself Handbook for the Do-It-Yourself Aquarist is a great book. But I've been doing this 11 years and I'm still not good at pitching and promoting and being a well-rounded YouTuber. I'm just a fish keeping hobbyist that just so happened to end up enjoying making videos as well. Hope you guys enjoyed today's video. That's enough of a rant. I gotta stop these rants.